This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and healthful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
Welcome to the monthly meeting of the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii. Thank you for coming. The Vegetarian Society of Hawaii is a not-for-profit volunteer organization founded in 1990 to promote human health, animal rights, and protection of the environment by means of vegetarian education. It's among the largest vegetarian societies in the nation with more than 2,000 members. We are delighted tonight to have with us Laurelee Blanchard, founder of and president of Leilani Farm Sanctuary, and Barry Sultanoff, MD. Laurelee Blanchard founded Leilani Farm Sanctuary, a nonprofit 501c3 organization to provide shelter to rescued animals and humane education to the community. The sanctuary offers special programs to youth groups and gives tours of the sanctuary to the general public. Laurelee also serves as a director of the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii. Barry Sultanoff, MD, a board member of Leilani Farm Sanctuary and vegan marathoner, received his medical degree from the University of Rochester with an undergraduate degree from Cornell University. Dr. Sultanoff is the co-author of Putting Out the Fire of Addiction. He runs, swims, paddles, practices yoga, and plays Japanese taiko drums. He also hosts a popular radio show on Manao Radio, FM 91.5, on Wednesdays from 6 to 10 a.m. In this presentation, Laurelee and Barry will give practical tips for transitioning toward a healthy diet free of animal products. They will also share interesting stories about the farm sanctuary and describe the healing effects animals have on people. Leilani Farm Sanctuary is a nonprofit organization dedicated to providing shelter to rescued animals and humane education to the community. Located in Haiku, Leilani Farm Sanctuary comprises 8 acres and is home to goats, chickens, donkeys, cats, and rabbits. Please welcome Laurelee Blanchard and Dr. Sultanoff.
Thank you very much for coming. I live life with an attitude of, I guess, deep awe about how precious it all is. And every one of us here has a human incarnation, you know, which is very auspicious in the practices that I follow. And it's also very auspicious to be incarnated as a non-human animal. In the news, I wanted to start by showing in the Maui Weekly, our humble little weekly newspaper here on Maui, one of our children one of our kids actually, and it's Johnny here. His name is better pronounced as Johnny. I think Laurelee, you did it better than I did.
Johnny.
But I dream of getting some bumper stickers made that say, you know, you've seen the kind that says our kid is an honor student, you know, and that kind of thing. I want one that says our kid is a goat. that's what I'm ready for. So this is Johnny. I want to pose a couple of questions here, just to kind of set a context. And the first question, these won't be hard to answer. Have you ever in your life eaten in a restaurant, been served food and eaten in a restaurant? How many have eaten at least once in their life at a restaurant? Is there anyone here that never ate at a restaurant? Okay. I think everyone. And the other is, if you think back over the past week, has there been any night that you've gone to bed hungry, the reason being that you were hungry but you had no access to food that would have satisfied your hunger so that you wouldn't be hungry anymore? Has anybody had that experience in the past week of going to bed hungry? In this world, there are a lot of people that we never get to meet, and there are people living in lots of different lifestyles. I don't know the exact statistics, but I would wager to say that at least half the people in this world have never in their life eaten in a restaurant. And that many, many people in this world go to bed hungry because they can't find any food to eat. I'm going to be talking here tonight about some specifics about food, but I think it's worth just, you know, pausing for a moment just to remember how magical it is that we're here and how precious it all is and how fortunate, especially how fortunate we all are, because we truly are. And if this world is going to be a better place, I think we need to somehow keep in our awareness that the entire world, we're not going to meet everybody, but the whole world. And I want to tell you a little story that has to do with a guy named Maurice Sendak. He's a writer of children's books and an illustrator. He's still with us. He's in his 80s. And he was being interviewed once by Terry Gross on National Public Radio. And Terry said to Maurice, she said, are there any interesting stories you have about your readers or things they've told you about the books and your young readers? And he said, oh, there are really quite a few. But let me tell you one that I really like. It's about a little boy named Jim. Maurice said, I received a card from Jim, and there was a little drawing on it. And Sendak said, I just love this card with the drawing. So I took out a card, and I drew a picture of a wild thing on it. And I wrote on the card, Dear Jim, I loved your card. And I sent him the card. And Sendak went on to say, a couple of weeks later, he heard from the boy's mother. And she said, Jim loved your card so much that he ate it. And Sendak said, you know, this to him was one of the highest compliments he'd ever received, because the boy didn't care that it was original Sendak. It was like, he saw it, he loved it, he ate it. You know? And I'm not here to advocate eating, you know, cards, even though they probably are vegan. I don't know, it's mostly, you know, carbon and paper pulp. But there's just a refreshing attitude in there, I thought, about just kind of going for life. And this is the context of what we're doing here. Because I feel like before we talk about details of food, you know, we should talk about, at least touch upon some of the general, what I consider the general guidelines. And for me, the acronym GLAD, since we're talking about being happy, GLAD, kind of helps me remember what some of those are. And the number one is gratitude. And you know, and it's said over and over, an attitude of gratitude. But if you want to have a happy heart, you just really notice just how great it all is. L is for local. And so if you can grow your own food, you're going to be on a really good track. If you aren't able to grow your own food, perhaps you can barter with neighbors. And if not that, maybe you can buy at a local food market. So the more locally grown the food that we eat, the better it is, because we're here attuned to this aina, and the food is attuned to the aina. And there's something about attunement. Food is about energetics, not just molecules. And A is for alive. And so the aliveness in foods is not as easy to measure, perhaps, as the protein content or the carbohydrate content or the mineral content. But the mana, you know, in Maui we call it, in Hawaii, the mana. The quality of mana in the food, the aliveness in the food, is extremely important. Live foods, if you begin to pay attention, you notice what they are. You can even, if you go into a farmer's market or even a supermarket, you can start feeling which foods are alive. Sprouts are one great example. They're alive because they're very fresh and new foods. So the aliveness. And the D for me is what I call dining in duo, meaning whenever possible, eat with a friend. You know, the tradition of sitting down and having a meal, I think, in American life, has largely been lost. Families are pretty scattered and fractured. But if you can eat together, Laurelee and I don't manage to have dinner together every night. But when we do, we light candles, we pause before we eat, sometimes say a little prayer. When two or more are gathered, there I am, you know. So that's my little, you know, quick acronym of what I think is important. You know, gratitude, eating local, how alive is the food, and choosing when we can foods that are alive. Laurelee and I live on a sanctuary, I think you know it, at Leilani Farm Sanctuary. We're co-directors of the sanctuary. We live surrounded by animals, and that happened because that was Laurelee's vision. She wanted to live surrounded by animals. We have a place called Animal Alley, and from our windows, you see the, you know, donkeys and goats romping down there, and sometimes the peahen, you know, is there too, and now there's a little deer at the sanctuary, and more when I look at it, it looks like an ark. Feel like, you know, just add rain and we'll be ready to float the thing somewhere, but I hope not too soon. But it's like there's so, and more animals come, you know, we're in this process of, we don't even know sometimes who's going to come next. So I want to go now to give you the audience, Laurelee, and show some slides and do your talk, and then I'll join you the later part of that. Okay? Great. Thank you.
Leilani Farm Sanctuary has really been in operation for about 11 years. That's how long we've been rescuing animals, but it was only about a year and a half ago that we became an official 501c3, and during that time we have received a lot of publicity and we've enhanced our focus toward education. Probably our primary mission, even above and beyond rescuing animals, is to educate people about the compassionate treatment toward animals. And that means carefully considering our food choices, the least amount of suffering on animals. And in this presentation, I'm going to show you some pictures of our residents and show you pictures of some of the visitors who have come and interacted with animals, and also say a few words about the animals who aren't as lucky as the ones who wound up at the sanctuary, the ones that unfortunately are being used for food production and who live on factory farms. We host many tours for youth groups and children who might otherwise never have a chance to interact with farm animals come and have the chance to bond with these animals. And fortunately for us, the animals love visitors, and nothing makes them happier than having people come and pay attention to them. Here's a scene of the barnyard from the upstairs window. And as you can see, there the chickens are around and the donkeys are coexisting with the goats, and everybody gets along beautifully. That's the goat house that you see in red there. Some of the kids, and adults too for that matter, have never held a chicken, and we always like to give them the opportunity to hold a chicken. And we've heard from many people who have visited the farm that after cuddling a chicken and looking a chicken in the eyes, they could never again eat a chicken. To us, that's success.
Yeah, our model for vegetarian eating is just hold the chicken.
These are two donkeys, and they look identical, as you can see in the photograph. They look like twins. They're not even related, but they look so much alike that we can't tell them apart except for by the way they behave. One of them is a kissing donkey, and the other is a hugging donkey. And the hugging donkey doesn't like to be kissed, and the kissing donkey loves to be kissed but won't tolerate being hugged. And that's the only way we can tell these two apart. This is a tour at the sanctuary of a children's group. We've hosted tours for developmentally disabled kids, at-risk children, seniors. Here are some seniors from a tour, and they're holding the baby goats. There was actually a group from the Kaunoa Senior Center who came to the sanctuary a few weeks ago. That's what you're looking at. And when people come, they really experience an opening of their heart when they get all this love from the animals and return the love back to them. Here's one of our special residents. His name's Johnny. He's a goat. He's the one who was featured in the Maui Weekly last week, and this was truly a success story. He was born on a goat meat ranch in Olinda with 60 other goats, and his mother was not nursing him. So as a brand new baby goat, the farmer had to bottle feed him. So several times a day, she'd bring him into the house and give him a bottle. And in the process, she bonded with him. And slowly but surely, she came to the decision that she could not stand the thought of him being butchered like all the other goats there. So she let him come to Leilani Farm Sanctuary. And we invited her to come back, to come and visit Johnny and see his new digs and see where he is living. So she did. She came and visited Johnny, and she brought her husband, a pig farmer. And they spent the whole afternoon meeting the animals, listening to us talk about how intelligent and sensitive the animals are. And they had a change of heart. They decided to get out of the goat business and get out, close down the piggery. So we were thrilled at that outcome. And this is a cat named Gordon. He was abandoned at the harbor. And I'm going to go kind of quickly through these because we have so many pictures to show you. And this is Richard the rooster. He was tethered to one of those A-frames at a cockfighting compound. And he was freed from there. Somebody went there at 6 o'clock in the morning and released him from his tether. And now he's at the sanctuary, where he's very happy. This is Pearl. She is our elegant white cat. She'd been living in a cage. This is one of our new residents. His name is Jerome. And he became an orphan when his mother was shot by hunters. And he looks like a little bull, I think. I think he looks like a little miniature cow. He's very cuddly and friendly. And this is a mother and daughter. The mother was already impregnated when she came to the sanctuary. Our policy is the animals are sterilized. We are not into reproduction, we're into rescue. So we don't allow any breeding at the sanctuary. But in this case, the mother had already been impregnated by her brother. The brother is Jack, and the mother is Jill, so the baby's name is Jackie, named after her dad. But they like to hang out in the feed bowl. And this is a little black chick named Akachan. We named her Akachan because we had a Japanese exchange student staying with us when this hen was brought to us. And she named her Akachan, which means baby in Japanese. And the hen was too little to be outdoors because she would have been vulnerable to predators and also vulnerable to hypothermia. So we had her in the house where we kept her warm on a heating pad. And she became one of the family. She got along great with the cats. All the house cats were very nice to her. She would sleep right in the bed. And we took her with us when we'd go out on the town. She went to restaurants and she went to an art gallery one time. Now that she's all grown up, she's out with the flock of chickens and she just congregates with all the wild chickens and is just like them. But she still has the affection for us. She likes to come in the house every day, and whenever we feel too lazy to vacuum clean and there are crumbs on the floor, she comes in and cleans up all the crumbs. And here she is in the house. She's all grown up, and you can see her there. She's in the cat cozy. And if you look behind her, you see the cats in the background. And she's ultra mellow. So she's a great ambassador for the sanctuary because when people come to visit, they cuddle with her. And she loves chicken reflexology. We give her foot massages every day. And she loves to have her feet massaged. This is Charlie. She was pregnant when somebody threw in a garbage dumpster beside a restaurant. And she had a litter of kittens. Only one kitten survived. 18 years later, she and the kitten are still together. This is her kitten, Alice. And they still live at the sanctuary. Here's one of our 5 rabbits. They have a special rabbit habitat. And they dug a huge tunnel in their rabbit garden, spans the distance from one end to the other. Fortunately, it doesn't go out of the enclosure. And it was just 2 days' time I watched them dig the tunnel. They were very industrious. This is a new peahen who came to the sanctuary a couple of weeks ago. Some people said that she just appeared on their property and she was eating their vegetation and they didn't want to have to kill her. And would we take her? So we did. This is one of the sanctuary cats. It's a kitten. In the next picture, you'll see her grown up. This is her all grown up. She's welcoming the new deer.
What's the deer's name?
The deer's name is Veronica, and she was found lost in a gulch. She's very, very affectionate. She's more affectionate than any of our goats, and the goats are super friendly. She just loves to be petted, and she tolerates being kissed right on the lips. Very friendly. And this is one of our feather-footed. He's like a little miniature rooster. He's called a bantam, and he's got feathers on his feet. It's Byron, and all of our animals are available for sponsorships. You can sponsor a chicken or a goat or any animal. And this one has a sponsor. He's being sponsored by Cat. This is a goat who likes to ride on the back of the donkeys. The goat's name is Danny. And several times a day, he'll jump on the donkey's back. The donkeys love this. I guess it feels like a shiatsu massage when they walk around on their backs. You'll see a succession of photos. Right here, he's getting ready to jump up. Here he is riding on the back. And they go all over the farm this way. The goat balances, and there he is, up on the back. And we also have one rooster named Ronnie who likes to ride around on the backs of the goats.
You got a picture of all three of them?
Oh, you mean in a pyramid?
Yeah, you got a super size. I don't think we ever got one of all three yet.
That would be a great one. We should do that. And this is Larry. He was kept tied up for 10 years. He was tied up all by himself, with no animals, and nobody ever pet him. He had never been petted. The people who had him received him as a birthday gift and never wanted him in the first place. They didn't know what to do with him. And the only way that they touched him was with a garden rake. So I left a note for them asking if he could come to the sanctuary because I felt so sorry for him. I used to see him every day when I'd go running past there. And didn't hear anything for 8 months. And then one day they called. They said, we're getting divorced and selling the house. We don't know what to do with him. You can have him, but you're not going to be able to touch him. He can't pet him or anything. And so he came. And 2 days later, he was laying his head in my lap. He turned out to be a really, really nice goat. And he's so happy to be free and able to walk around and to live among other goats that he's exceeded the average lifespan for a goat. And this is one of the children getting acquainted with a goat. This is Ned. And this is a little boy who plans to be a veterinarian when he grows up. And I really think he will. I think his vision will be realized. I think he will be a veterinarian. His name's Gato. And this is the Akachan chicken who we talked about earlier. That's Natalie the kitten. It's Akachan again. Here's a little girl holding a little baby goat named Annie. Her name's Maria. The adults like animals as much as the kids do. Close up of the little goat. This is one of our regular farm tours that we host for the public on Wednesdays at 4:00 and Saturdays at 10:00. We're open to the public. Anybody can come and get a complete tour of the sanctuary and learn about the animals. Here's one of our advisory board members. He's a veterinarian. He lives in Canada part-time and Maui the other part of the time, cuddling the little Annie goat here. This is the kissing donkey. This is another visitor. She's also a veterinarian, and she was helping us bathe the goat. The goat had to have a special surgical procedure that requires him to get baths frequently, so she was helping us out with that. That's me doing my farm chores. Donkey giving the kiss. Donkey with their tongue out giving a kiss. Another visitor who had never held a chicken before. There's our special bird, Akachan. This is the future vet. His name's Gato. Visitors in the rabbit yard. And there's the veterinarian again. She's holding a chicken and kissing a donkey simultaneously. And here is one of our other chickens who we raise from a little peep inside the house. This one's name is Avipur. She was raised in the house at a different time than the other bird, but for some reason they both seemed to know that they were both house birds and they'd become best friends. And that's Cat who's kissing the bird. And this is Dan Ferraro. He's going to be next month's speaker. He's the Bizarro cartoonist. This is one of our other advisory board members. Her name is Suki. Here's another one of our speakers, Dana Lyons, the singer and songwriter, was here a couple months ago, and he came to the farm. He's the one who's famous for the song cows with guns. That's him with the donkeys.
He's up online now, by the way.
Oh, great.
Yeah, he's already up.
And here is a brother and sister pair of chickens. We have regular community work days at the sanctuary. And this is a picture of some volunteers shoveling up compost. We just had a very successful one this past Saturday. We had probably 25 volunteers come and do a variety of tasks. We got all 10 goats' hoofs trimmed that day, and we got the barn cleaned out, and we got the garden weeded, and we got the lawn mowed, all kinds of things. And Flatbread was generous enough to donate pizza for the occasion. Everybody had a great time. And back in April, we were gifted with a fruit orchard. The Fruit Tree Planting Foundation of America has this program called Orchards for Animals, where they go to sanctuaries and they plant fruit trees that can be used to feed the animals. And so they came, and in one afternoon, 30 trees were planted. And they're already producing tons of bananas. And when we have surplus fruit that the animals aren't interested in, like citrus, most of the animals aren't that crazy about citrus, we donate it to the Maui Food Bank through this program called Waste Not, Want Not. They come and pick it, and then it either goes to the Maui Food Bank or to the senior. Probably our primary mission for having the sanctuary is to have the animals represent the species of animals that people might otherwise consider as food. And so our main goal is to educate people about what goes on factory farms. And it's never a pleasant subject, but being aware of it, we feel like we have a responsibility to the animals to get the information out there. So we're going to talk a little bit about what happens on the factory farms. These are some pigs that are being raised in gestation crates, and this is very typical in the industry. The pigs are placed in these crates that are so narrow that they can't turn around. This is how they live 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They never see the light of day. They never get to experience the grass under their feet. This is how they live. And pigs are extremely intelligent animals, so it's very frustrating for them to be kept this way. And this is a picture of egg-laying hens in an egg factory. And this is standard in the industry. We had an egg factory right here on Maui, and the egg factory closed down, thank goodness. And when they did, dozens upon dozens of chickens were just left to starve to death. So some of us went late at night with flashlights and retrieved all the live chickens. We probably got about 60 live chickens, but hundreds and hundreds and hundreds were dead. We had to trample over all the corpses of the dead ones 2.5 years ago. Okay. That was a place in Makua, Makani Road. And here's a picture of the rescue. This is one of the chickens being handed to the activist. Each of the chickens got a wonderful home. Another consequence of the egg business is that all the male chicks are destroyed since they can't lay eggs, and since they're the wrong stock to produce the meat, they're of no use to the egg industry. So they're killed either by being suffocated in plastic bags or being thrown into a macerator, which is a grinder, alive. So by giving up eggs, you're saving these chicks. The dairy industry, unfortunately, is among the most cruel industries out there. These milk-producing cows are kept on concrete floors. They're milked with automatic milking machines that sometimes cause shocks. They're pumped full of growth hormones to maximize the milk production, and in the process they end up with infected udders called mastitis, and then sometimes the bacteria and the pus ends up in the milk. One very negative consequence of the dairy industry is that it's fueling the veal industry, because the male calves born to these milk-producing cows obviously can't produce milk, so they're used for veal. And then the females once they're spent and no longer produce the milk, they are slaughtered. And usually they're slaughtered for hamburger because that's the lower quality. And they wind up at McDonald's or someplace similar. So we're very happy that we don't participate in this cruelty. And our philosophy is living a vegan lifestyle is a very good formula for happiness. And now we're going to have Dr. Sultanoff give some suggestions about how to transition away from animal products to healthy plant-based products.
I went to medical school in the 60s. I graduated in 1970 with the degree MD. I come from a tradition of heart disease. Most of the men in my family die at 50. My father died at 50. His father died at 50. I have the same hereditary condition. And I have a brother who's 8 years younger. He does some health practices, but certainly not with the attention that I do. A few years ago, he had a quintuple bypass surgery. He just barely made it. This was in his early 50s, barely survived. So this is someone with very similar genetics, presumably, to mine. And so, I mean, I love life. I told you, I'm passionate. So I take it seriously, how to live life that's really lived to the fullest, but at the same time, not just for me, but for the planet and for all living beings. How do we look at that and what's the answer? So just, you know, briefly in terms of what kind of foods are good for happiness, it appears to me that what you need to do, and for some of you this is pretty obvious, but that the heart is not just a physical organ. Heart is mind, body, feeling, energy. And whatever is good for the physical heart, the things that we know are good in terms of helping to prevent and even in Dean Ornish's program, for example, reversing heart disease, that's the very same foods that keep us happy because the heart is the organ of love and happiness. You know, we know it's here. It's not just a pumping, it's not just a pump. In medical school, we were taught the heart is a pump, you know. Well, yeah, it's a pump. It's a good thing it keeps pumping, right? But it's so much more than that. So that everything we've learned about preventing heart disease, it can be applied to preventing depression. I've worked most of my career as a psychiatrist, so I've mostly worked with people who are so-called depressed. And one of the best ways I can help them is to have them look at what they're eating. The less animal products, the better. You know, I mean, it's like the less, the better. You know, people can transition away from animal products, and the less sugar, the better. You know, high fructose corn syrup. Bad news. And it's in so many foods that you find in supermarkets. It's easier to eat less calories, or what would be an optimal amount of calories, if you eat plant-based diet versus meat, you know, protein diet here, or fatty diet, because the stomach itself is going to feel more satisfied, more full with, here we're saying 400 calories, you know. I think what's happened is that people's entire metabolism has been thrown just way off. For instance, the hunger mechanism that tells us when we're hungry. We've got people who's, because they've eaten so much sugar and so many additives, the mechanism itself has been thrown off. The pancreas is, you know, the insulin is pumping all the time. It's and becomes depleted finally in the pancreas. And people are full and overweight, but they really think they're hungry. I mean, they're hungry. It's crazy. They're getting a signal to eat, even though they're eating way, way too much. Just ate 6 happy meals, and I'm still depressed. Well, yeah. Serotonin. Yeah, these are, it's good to have the right serotonin in the brain, crossing the nerve synapses. There's a whole set of antidepressants, which are called selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, the SSRIs, what was the new generation of antidepressants, but now it's not all that new. You know, the Prozac, for instance. SSRIs, and that helps maximize the amount of serotonin causing these gaps. Foods high in tryptophan. Tryptophan tends to be relaxing in the system, and so here's some foods that have tryptophan that we recommend. Brown rice, black-eyed peas, soybeans, seeds, nuts, tofu, almonds, you know, foods that to us are foods. They grow somewhere. They have life energy in them. Omega-3 fats. are very good for balancing the blood fats, you know, to help prevent heart disease, but they're also very good for balancing the mood, as it turns out. And there are some sources of omega-3 fats. I'm always so glad to see chocolate high on the list, I must tell you, of mood-enhancing foods. I love to think of chocolate as a health food, and it is. And tonight, I carefully selected for you at Down to Earth some dark chocolate-covered blueberries. They actually had a new product there. We got bowls. It's like wonderful blueberries covered with dark chocolate. I mean, I could live on that, couldn't you? And it's good for you. But these are some foods that are considered mood-enhancing, avocados and chocolate-covered almonds. Could have gotten those, but I went for the blueberries, stimulating the release of serotonin. Complex carbohydrates. We do need carbohydrates, but we want the ones that are like putting logs on a fire, right? We want the complex carbohydrates. And processed foods, as you probably well know, are just reeking with simple sugars. Better to get it from the trees or from the ground. You know, here on Maui, we've got things falling out of the trees. You know, there's more food than we can eat. Endorphins are, you know, chemicals that are produced endogenously. You feel good. You get kind of a mood enhancement. You get it from long distance running, from certain foods that increase endorphin levels. Healthy fats like olive oil, almonds, walnuts, avocados. And in general, vegetarians and vegans do have a lower risk of the major maladies that affect our world, shown in many, many studies. I've outlived my dad by 15 years. I ran a marathon this year. I don't want to boast. I want to be an example. You know, I mean, it's got to make a difference. My brother can hardly walk. I mean, he's, you know, his big, big belly and everything. He's a wonderful guy. He's a humor guy. And he gives lectures on humor and psychotherapy, and I love him. And I mentioned earlier about eating together, you know, how wonderful it is if you have a partner or a friend, if your habit has been to eat alone, you know, to have eating be a time of celebration. This guy, Scott Jurek, is an ultra-marathoner, a vegan ultra-marathoner. So it is possible. This is not news probably to most of you or any of you, but it is possible to eat a very healthy diet and a no animal product diet and be extremely healthy and even very, very athletic. And I was astonished. I mean, I've done 3 triathlons on Maui in the last 5 years, and, you know, Olympic length triathlons. I never did that before. I'm an old guy, you know. You know, I love it. At the beginning of my first triathlon, I was on the beach ready to go into the water, and some guy in his early 20s, I'm guessing he might have been 21, he looked at me, you know, and he said, "Uncle," he said, "let's kick butt." You know, and I said, "This is why I'm here." So this 21-year-old guy said to me, "Let's kick butt." He finished ahead of me. Ruth Heidrich, she's a marathoner in her Iron Woman. Yeah, they do the ultra, really the long, long distance ones I'd never try. But after breast cancer, getting up there, 70s, okay. So cholesterol, you know, this is, of course, as with physical heart disease, so with happy eating. Same rules. And this is a beautiful vegetarian treat made by Brook and Holm, I think. Probably. I think they sent us this picture. You know, it's got avocado and fresh vegetables and wrapped in, I think, sea vegetable. Any products that help make the transition. Of course, bananas, good, you know, star fruits. Changing recipes where you can substitute for meat, TVP, and other forms of soy products. So for some people who are used to eating meat and think that if they take meat out of their diet, they're really going to miss something, a good way to go is to use meat substitutes. You know, you can still eat bologna if you want to. Just it's made of soy, that's all. But it's bologna-like. Burgers, of course, Boca burgers. You can still have your sausages for breakfast, only they're
Akachan.
Okay.
Okay, which one's that?
That's this one.
This is Akachan.
Okay, good.
Akachan is the black chicken.
Yeah.
Natalie's our theatrical cat. She loves to be on camera.
Oh, yeah.
Any opportunity. She
So when little Akachan was a newly hatched chick, 1 day old, the size of an egg, she became separated from her mother and the flock, and she was brought to us. And because she was all by herself and so young, we had to bring her indoors with us and keep her warm on a heating pad. And she stayed in the house where she'd be safe from predators. She became really tame and personable from spending all that time in the house.
Was she in danger of becoming an omelet?
No, she was just a wild. She was just a wild chicken in the jungle, so okay. She was vulnerable to predators and to hypothermia.
So she's a second-generation feral chicken.
Yes.
Okay.
She's an interesting chicken because when I observe her life, it's as if she has two different lives. She has a life as a wild chicken who's a member of the flock. In fact, this is one of her close buddies, one of her close women friends. And they have a male friend. His name is Richard. And the three of them hang out together like the three musketeers or whatever it would be in, you know, chicken terms. And she also has a life as a very tame chicken. In fact, we have a mirror out here on the porch, and in the mornings she comes to the mirror and she preens herself in the mirror.
And their boyfriend Richard was liberated from a cockfighting camp. We have more than 50 chickens, and they include roosters and hens.
Okay, well, next question. How many chickens do you think Colonel Sanders does in every day? Give me an estimate.
You mean the colonel in particular, or do you mean he and his henchmen, the colonel diaspora? You mean around the United States or the world, really?
Colonel Sanders in a generic sense. How many?
You know, we're talking certainly hundreds of thousands, millions, maybe.
Yeah. So, what's the point of running this huge sanctuary to take care of chickens and other abused animals when there's so many that are being massacred for food?
Well, by saving these few, even though they only represent a spit in the ocean, we are able to educate the visitors by having these few as the emissaries. So the people who come meet the chickens and they discover what wonderful, warm, sensitive, intelligent animals they are. And after cuddling with the chicken and making eye contact with the chicken, they rethink their food choices.
Yeah, and especially the children. You know, I mean, I think changes are not likely to happen in a matter of just a few years, but there's another whole generation coming in, and we see, you know, young children here very eager to, you know, to hold and touch a chicken and to have a little relationship with a chicken that's so different than being in a supermarket and seeing a cellophane packaging with some pinkish kind of thing inside of it, and that's chicken. And so just hoping, as Laurelee said, the best emissary is the word that I use too, that these special ones that have, through grace or a miracle or whatever, have managed to survive and to live in a place like this, are emissaries of all their chicken friends. You know, they're the ones living in a kind of a paradise world in a natural, normal way that can be greeted and touched and held by children and by their families. And it's really amazing to watch the shift in people when they, if you hold an animal, it changes your relationship, I think, forever. You know, it's like you're actually connecting in a deep, powerful way.
Yes, we have tours twice a week, every Saturday at 10 a.m. and every Wednesday at 4 p.m. We have tours for the general public. And in addition to that, we also host tours for special groups. We host tours for children's groups, school field trips, seniors groups. Well, one of our donkeys was rescued after living in the dark crawl space of under somebody's house with no sunlight and no other animals.
Were they in dire peril?
Yes, she really was.
I mean, were they going to wind up getting killed or eaten or something?
Well, one of our first donkey, the namesake for the sanctuary, Leilani, was going to be auctioned off. And she probably would have been used by hunters as a pack animal to hike out of the forest with the animal carcass. When they go and shoot the deer and the pigs, they need a donkey to carry the animal carcass.
Okay.
So she might have been used for that had we not taken her.
Hey, can we get a little interaction between... So now we got a third member of the party.
Yes. See, we have cats here, and sometimes people say, are the chickens, you know, safe around the cats, if the cats are on the chickens? Actually, it's the cats that have to really, really beware.
The chickens are the bosses.
The chickens rule. you wouldn't know that unless you lived here, but the chickens definitely, their beaks, I think, are a very strong message to cats.
The cats know not to mess with the chickens. In fact, they don't even mess with the little tiny chicks.
Is it really just one big happy family here? I mean, all the donkeys and the chickens and the goats and the...
Yes, they all coexist.
They all get along okay.
And we have 5 rabbits, 10 goats, 2 donkeys, 1 peahen, 10 cats, and a deer. We have one goat named Danny who likes to go for rides on the back of the donkey. He jumps onto the back of the donkey, and the donkey loves this because it feels like she's getting a massage, a shiatsu massage. And they go all around the farm, I mean the goat balancing on the back of the donkey. And then we have one rooster named Ronnie who likes to ride around on the backs of the goats.
In fact, Ronnie thinks one of the goats is like his wife. That's what you all think. I mean, I don't know if he really thinks that, but he treats the goat as if it's his mate. But I can't think of one example where any animal here has deliberately harmed another animal here.
No.
Not at all.
Never.
I mean, but there are accidents that happen where, you know, a bird might get, you know, under the hoof of a goat or, you know, but I don't think there's any example of any animal here deliberately harming any other animal, its own species or another species.
They have good hearts.
So in that way, it is one big happy family. But I used to watch this one, very young, go in front of the mirror. And I saw the process of her discovering another bird for the first time, which was, of course, herself. But it was clear that she saw it as another bird. So I love to write poems about the animals. I've written a number of poems about the donkeys and about Avi Purr. And so the poem is called Mirror Story, and it comes from my observation of this young bird in front of the mirror discovering for the first time another bird. So here's how it goes. Avi the chick stands entranced by the glass, reflecting upon what she sees. There is one other bird in her rectangled world, looking much like herself, yet completely reversed. This welcoming friend appears here every day, as given as cornmeal and worms after rain. Once again, the time slows to a tick of her avian clock. She seems to grow faster than minutes pass by. Her tough chicken feet hold my sigh in their claws. This pleasure I measure in awes as I pause to take in her Zen practice so pure. Just a gaze unafraid and a seeing that all is full well. There's another like she in this world of reflection. There is no dissension nor anything much even worthy of mention. Each day she returns to this bird contemplation and preens her seen friend with her loving, devoted attention. And I wrote that poem in March of 09, actually on Japanese Girls' Day, which is the March 3rd of 09.
Okay. Tell me how a deer gets to be interactive with people. I mean...
We don't know much about her background, but she must have been...
You think she was a pet?
I think what probably happened was hunters killed her mother and took her home and Pam raised her because she's very tame.
I'm gonna get the white ones because they are spectacular.
beautiful.
You're magnificent.
Look at that. Ah, it's color. Where are your goats?
They're way down in the pasture grazing, but we...
How old do you think Veronica is?
Probably a few months old.
Over here.
Veronica was found lost in a gulch, and she was brought here.
And what would happen to her if you had run out of here?
Somebody would have shot her. A hunter would have killed her.
Why would a hunter kill her?
To eat her.
Richard Wagner, 1880. I start from the religious conviction that the degeneration of the human race has been brought about by its departure from its natural food. The only basis of a possible regeneration, a return to it.
Dr. Anna Kingsford, 1882. The ordinary flesh eater, if he be a man of any perception, is always fain to acknowledge, on being pressed, that there is something in the usual mode of feeding which clashes with his finer sense of what ought to be. He would rather not talk about the slaughterhouse, and more or less frankly admits that he cannot associate the idea of slaughter with what are called the utopian theories of existence.
In 1887, Tolstoy said, "If a man's aspirations towards a righteous life are serious, if he earnestly and sincerely seeks a righteous life, his first act of abstinence is from animal food."
Ruth Harrison, 1920. That animals are sensitive to pain and discomfort is obvious from the fact that in the higher animals, the sensory and nervous systems are similar to those of man.
Henry Bailey Stevens, 1963, said, "In their concern over the world crisis, most peacemakers have given little heed to the fact that man operates two major forms of blood violence, The larger of these is not the intermittent spasm of war, which has occurred perhaps once in a generation. It is the steady, day-by-day intake and outflow of the abattoir.
This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344, or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
Thank you.